Go ahead and get started. So thanks everyone for coming out this morning. I know this was one of the sessions that was embargoed till after the keynote, so I appreciate people finding us and having interest in the topic. My name's Eric Winner. I'm a program manager on the System Center team, specifically working on Virtual Machine Manager. And my colleague Mark Yumeno is going to help out in this presentation, and we're going to explain how the new infrastructure as a service work for on-premise. Some of the details behind that and the motivation behind that. You probably saw the keynote demo. We're going to basically go behind the scenes of that keynote demo and show how that works, how that's enabled, go deep into the gallery and the artifacts behind that. So should be a pretty good deep session. Just these reminders. Okay, so this slide should be familiar with everyone. So we are definitely focused on this consistent experience for the whole new cloud OS as introduced in the keynote. That encompasses websites, service bus, virtual machines, and an API and portal experience. And that's across all the clouds, whether it's running in your data center as an enterprise, running at a service provider that you use, or running in Windows Azure. Today's topic, we're going to drill deep on that orange section there on the virtual machines. So we're going to go pretty deep there. We're really not going to talk about any of the other stuff in this session. There's plenty of sessions covering the other pillars of this consistency experience. So when we started down this path, we talked to a lot of customers about what's going on, where you're headed. Enterprises we've been pretty close within System Center and Windows for a long time. We then spent some time talking to service providers specifically. And then talking to enterprises, what are their needs of service providers? So this was a bit of a pivot on our typical focus. But as we all know, right, the workloads running in the service providers come from the enterprise. So there's a really tight coupling there, and we're really trying to make sure that enterprises have a great choice among service providers, Azure, and their own data center, and they can run these workloads anywhere. So the first thing customers typically ask us for is, they want a consistent user experience. They don't want to go to three or four different consoles on premise. They don't want to have three or four self-service portals, which we had ourselves for Virtual Machine Manager as we sort of were pushing some of these ideas out for feedback. And they don't want to have an Azure experience that's different from on-premise, that's different than the service providers they're interacting with. They can't train their users. They really just it's a big hurdle to adoption if every time you come out with something, there's a whole new user interface. So we're really focused on consistent user experience. And for us, that's not just about UI. There's also some consistent artifacts we want to apply. And at the API level, we're looking for consistency. And at the PowerShell level. So we're really looking for consistency in all the layers as much as we can provide. So whether you're using the portal, you're scripting, you're writing code, we want that to also be consistent as possible. We're not always, maybe not always able to achieve 100% runs anywhere, especially in these first few baby steps we're taking, but our goal is to get there. And we also heard people say, look, I want to have a way of capturing my workload into a deployment artifact, into a template, and make that work across all the clouds, right? I don't want to have to keep repackaging my application every time I go to deploy it into one of these new environments. And that's the OS configuration plus application. That's supporting scale out, things like, you know, put my websites behind a load balancer, all these kind of primitives. Try and figure out a way to solve that for me so I can have that to any cloud I'm interacting with. Sort of hand in hand with that, it was, well, it'd be great if you guys could provide a gallery of applications, right? The common applications we want to run, be it SQL, IIS, SharePoint, Exchange, Link. We hear a lot of customers just saying, why can't you provide some ready-made artifacts for me that I can use to deploy it in maybe a, might be a constrained way, but I can get it up and running, and then make them also open so I can take a look and say, that's great, but I'm going to tweak it a little for my taste. So, you know, we're looking at providing this gallery as well as providing a way for you to author your own, for you to take these samples and gallery items and customize them for your environment. And then we get down to When I'm running at a service provider, we talk to a lot of service providers, a lot of enterprises that are trying to be an internal service provider, and one of the number one support calls they have is someone messed up their VM, they tweaked its network, they can't RDP to it, generates a lot of support calls, people just having to go and restart the VM, whether it's stuck in a certain state or just off the network. And so we're going to show you some details around how we're going to enable you to get to the console of a VM without needing to know the host. So that's the other problem. There were some ways to do it if you wanted to hook your Hyper-V, put your Hyper-V host on the internet, then you could do it. But obviously, people don't want to do that. And then if you're a service provider and you've got two different VMs from two different companies on the same host, you really can't do that. So a lot of really tricky things to happen here, and we'll go through in detail how we got this to work and what you're going to need to deploy to get it to work in your environment. And then just we retain the standalone VMs, and they are great for, you know, what they've always been good for, but it's really the management concepts are bubbling up and it's really not enough anymore. So go beyond just standalone VMs. So this was a lot of the feedback that we heard loud and clear. So with that feedback, we developed this vision. And the vision is not 100% what we're delivering today, but it is our North Star. It's where we're headed. It drives all our decisions as we corral all the products into this common path. And it is right here written in front of you. A consistent service model across Windows Server, System Center, Windows Azure, for composing, deploying, and scaling out your virtualized apps and workloads, right? And this isn't specific to infrastructure as a service. This should encompass infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, software as a service, right? It's not specific to any of these. It's a broader vision than that. And then we break that down into these four pillars, which, you know, mimic that feedback that we heard. So we want user experiences, deployment artifacts, APIs, and then across the clouds, on-premise, hosted, and Azure. So this is a guiding principle, a vision. We're not going to get there in this release. We're probably not going to get there in the next release, but this is where we're headed. So specifically, so now this is what I want to talk about, what we did for infrastructure as a service in the 2012 R2 release. And we built all of this in partnership with Windows Azure team, System Center team, Windows Server team. So we did focus on the portal experience. So we're going to deliver an IaaS gallery. We're going to show that to you today. We're going to explain how it works. Site-to-site networking, I believe we're going to also show how you set that up as well. And across Windows and Linux guests, so we don't want to forget about Linux, right? And in much the same way you see Mark Rusinovich talk about Linux and demo Linux, we definitely want to keep that in play because we don't want to restrict that out. I'll show you these deployment artifacts in detail today, right? What the gallery items look like, how you define a virtual machine role, which is that scale-out tier, how you represent your application, how you link it to VHDs that you need to boot off of to get there. I don't think we're going to go into detail on the API today, but there is a consistent set of APIs, and as the release rolls, we'll have documentation on that for you to look at. We're not going to quite go as deep as API in this session. And the clouds that we're encompassing in the 2012 R2 release are the service provider hosted clouds running on the Windows Server System Center 2012 R2 stack, or something you install in your data center that's using the Windows Azure pack, Windows Server 2012 R2, and System Center 2012 R2. Now, for the astute among you, you'll notice Windows Azure is not in this list yet, and we really have no specific time frame around when it will be in this list, but we're on that path. Right, and there'll be more information coming over time as we can bring that up to speed. As you know, Windows Azure just really launched their standalone VM infrastructure as a service, and this is a step beyond that as a virtual machine role, which is a scale-out tier of VMs. But we work with them, and we're on the right path there, I think. We just don't have anything to share today. Okay, with that, I think I'll turn it over to Mark, and we'll get out of PowerPoint and into demos.
All right. How many of you were just in the previous session where we were talking about the overview? Okay. So, I'm sorry. So I'm going to repeat some of that because not everybody has seen the end-to-end demo. And if you don't see the tenant demo, it's very hard to follow the details that we're going to present later. So just bear in mind that this is we're presenting this more so that you can understand the virtual machine rolling gallery, less so because you want to see consumer demos over and over again. So as Eric mentioned, we really want to talk about the new virtual machine role in the gallery. I do want to mention that these we also still support standalone VMs using VMs, VM templates and virtual machine manager exposed through SPFs. It's this kind of same thing that was done in the previous release. But the new thing is this gallery, so in the virtual machine role. So I can click virtual machine role from gallery. Here I get a list of VM. Actually, I'm going to zoom out because it's a little bit too blown up. Okay, I get a gallery of templates that have been offered to me by my admin, and that was provisioned in the gallery. And we'll go into details about that a little bit later. The main point is that this is a curated list that is specific to my user role. So different user roles, different subscriptions can have different sets of gallery items. So I have this one here. I go into here. I can click demo. There's multiple versions that are available here. So multiple templates that have the same name and publisher, but just different version numbers. And then multiple subscriptions can be handled on the same account and same UI. I'll pick one of those. Here I have instance count, and that's a big change, right? This is the scalable part of it. So you can have 1 to 5 VMs. That was defined in the back end in the template, and Eric will go into great detail about how that actually looks in the model, and actually how it looks in JSON even. So, one thing to note is that these virtual machine roles have two pieces to them. They have a virtual machine container piece and then an application piece. So the virtual machines get provisioned, and I'm filling out settings for that right now. And then the second part will have applications where there's a payload and instructions to install and settings to install and config to install the application inside of the virtual machines. Okay, so I can pick instance count. I can pick a size that is the same list of settings that were available today in Azure minus A6 and A7. So I can pick like small or something. Down here, a very interesting. Oh, another point to make for these is that these settings are configurable in Virtual Machine Manager. You can run some PowerShell and change the settings. So number of cores, number of memory can be configurable per VM size. This one over here on the OS VHD. We actually will go through in a demo later on how you tag the VHD in VMM using PowerShell, which gives a set of characteristics that then the portal can query for, right? So right here I have this defined in the gallery item some requirements, some tags. I think it says like Windows Server 2012 and data center or something like that is the tags. And it has a certain family name or a certain OS version, and it has a certain version of the VHD. And we look for those tags, and we go back into VMM, query VMM, and that finds a list of VHDs that satisfy those needs. The reason why that's very valuable is because now we can take this template to any cloud, and instead of having to bind it inside of VMM, right, every time that you import it, you can be a loose coupling. And so I can take that at runtime, actually, and then bind it right now in the UI. Down here in the network reference, these are networks that are available to me in my user role, in my subscription. Here I can just supply a username for the admin. This is just a sample gallery item, so there's maybe a few more settings than you normally have. I should show you this. Like if I try to type a password that is not valid, there's UI validation that says, you know, must contain 8 characters and other things like that. So. You can build in UI validation rules into the wizard that you declare in the thing. Try again. All right, pick a time zone or whatever, and then computer name pattern. That's the same pattern that is used inside of VMM. So you can pick all sorts of patterns for naming each of the individual computer names. Here is the second part, and this is different than the normal filling out a template and getting a VM, right? I can actually, on this gallery item actually deploys a website with this site name, this application pool name, and this port. So I can type in whatever I want, I click the box, and it goes and creates one of these guys. Okay, so I already ran through that, and I created one here. FinWeb portal. So here there's a standard overview. Down here in the dashboard, here you see that we're hitting VMM APIs to fill out the quota for my subscription, number of cores, virtual machines for this role. The dark gray is how much is used for the rest of the VMs in my subscription, and then there's the total on my quota. Those quotas are set in a plan in the Windows Azure pack, and then a user creates a subscription to those and gets these quotas and gets which resources are available to them. Down here, there's a set of devices that are associated with this VM role. Here, there's VM instances, so I can go down here and see specific information, like especially like the IP address of the VM. In this case, I have a public IP address. I could remote desktop connect to that IP address over the internet and get to it. Because it's an individual VM, I can do control it. If you want, for some reason, you can configure the individual VM, at least for temporarily, until a new template's applied to the role. Here, you can scale. So it's within the limits of that gallery item, from 1 to 5 instances, you can scale the number of VMs. They can be done, you know, in the UI or via API. And here is a configure tab where you're actually capturing the settings that are filled out through the wizard. Okay? So this is actually another piece of artifact that lives in VMM and is associated with that user. So if you go and change that, that is applies only to that VM role instance. And Eric, again, will go into details about how that works. But now here you can see that in the UI. The question was about the external IP address. And so what I did in this VMM is I created a logical network. I bought a set of IP addresses from my hoster that I'm running this at, and I'm assigned an external IP, the IP pool inside of VMM. And then there's a way to expose that to a tenant, and then the tenant gets to consume that. Azure Online provides, you know, in the cloud, when Microsoft runs the data center, Azure provides those IPs. Because this is running in an enterprise data center, a service provider data center, that those organizations have to provide the IP addresses. Okay. I think so. The question was, if I get a Azure VM IP address assigned to it, then does it get persist? And I think the answer is yes. It's a static IP. Okay. All right, so there's also network capability. So I can go virtual network, custom create a virtual network for me as a tenant. I can fill out information about VPN, for example. So if this is running at a service provider, I can pick the DNS server of my company and configure a site-to-site VPN, provide an IP address space, and provide the enterprise-side VPN endpoint. So VMM automatically generates a VPN endpoint at the service provider, and you just need to have a corresponding one on the tenant side. And you would get, as a tenant, you would normally not know this stuff. You would have to ask your network admin. They would give it to you, and so you can create that connection. So you just fill this out, and then you can create a VM network. And the last thing I wanted to share was, in the tenant side anyways, later on I'll talk about the admin side, we have now the ability to do console connect. So if I go into like a Linux VM here and click dashboard. And the interesting thing about this one is that if this thing is running to a service provider, I can't actually get to the VM host because the hosts are not exposed to the internet. Right, so I need another way to get in when the VM doesn't support remote desktop into the guest OS. So for this one, we get in via the host using RDP protocol. And we made changes. We're about to make changes into Windows Server 2012 R2, Hyper-V, and Remote Desktop, and Remote Desktop Gateway to support this on the server side. And then we made some changes to SPF to support that in the on the System Center side. So what I can do is I can click Console, Connect. It downloads an RDP file. I'll talk about the details of that later, a little bit later on. But I want to show you what that looks like first. And now I can get into a Linux VM, even though it doesn't support RDP into the guest. I can also do that for a VM that doesn't have an operating system or a network. So if I go down to here, and this guy doesn't have a network, doesn't have an operating system, I can connect to it, same thing, a console. Now, the reason why I can get to this this VM is because it's been scoped to me in my subscription. So somebody in a different subscription, if they try to download that RDP file, they wouldn't be allowed, basically. SPF controls access there. And so here you see a VM with no OS, no network, and I can still get to it and do what I need to do as a tenant. All right, and again, I'll show a little bit later about how that works. So that's my tenant demo. And again, the reason why we did this is not to show a bunch of tenant features as much as it is to show to give you better grounding in what we're trying to accomplish here in this release. Okay, so I do have some slides. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about the architecture. So we had shipped a version of this stack in January, and already we're coming up with another version in this release. It basically has the same architecture. So it has Hyper-V, Virtual Machine Manager, SPF, and then the Windows Azure pack with the Service Management API and its portals above that. Okay, so that's the main IaaS stack here. In addition, there's integration with Orchestrator, and later on in a session at about 3 p.m., they're going to talk in great detail about how you can hook up an SPF call to an Orchestrator runbook. Right, that provides a lot of extensibility options. And then we use Operations Manager, Data Warehouse, to get usage metering data. Okay, so you monitor the usage of network I/O storage, network bandwidth storage, number of CPUs, memory, things like that that a tenant consumes, and also that are available in the cloud. So we use both of those as well as VMM, but VMM is the main piece of the System Center along with SPF. Okay, so if you were going to try to set this up yourself, what would you have to do? So the first thing you have to do is you take an application extension and you put it into VMM. Okay? And that is, I think, a ResXPKG. And Eric, again, will talk about a lot of details about that. But just think about this at the high-level flow. So I put the package that has the app into VMM. I put the gallery item, which has the VM definition and the UI definition into SPF, and I can use a service admin portal to do that. Right? Then I can, once that's in there, I can offer that to tenants using the service admin UI, and I'll demo all of these steps later on. And then you saw the other two pieces. A tenant goes to the gallery, creates a VM role, and then they can manage it over time. Okay, so that's the end-to-end of how to do that, and you've seen the 4 and 5, and we're going to do 1, 2, 3 later. All right, so in that gallery, you can import these gallery items using and it has the resource definition package and the view definition, which Eric will talk a lot of detail about later. Maybe too much, a lot of details that were shown. You can publish it and unpublish it quickly so that if you have it deployed to many, many, many different plans with many, many different subscriptions and for some reason you need to take it offline to edit it or something and put it back, then you have a quick way of doing that. And then the main way you offer that to tenants is that you put it into their plans, and then they subscribe to those plans. Or if they're already subscribed to those plans, they'll get updated with that access to that new. So this is the way we ACL access to these guys. Okay, on the tenant side, I think you saw all of these features. So scale out, scale in, update settings, upgrade to new version is something that I forgot to show, but it's in there. Then you control a VM. Again, we support VM templates, and I think earlier in the previous session we talked about support for direct Active Directory integration as well as federation using ADFS. Okay, and also the ability to do co-admins where a normal usage pattern would be to put an AD group as the co-admin of a subscription and then manage user membership outside of this thing, just your normal AD membership tools. Okay, AD groups. Down here in the tent networks, I kind of spun through this because there were two sessions that went into super great detail yesterday by Greg Cassanza. So if you haven't had a chance to look at those, I highly recommend going through those sessions on the online recordings, because he went through a great amount of detail about how you set up the fabric and how you set up site-to-site networking. All right, so it was a huge thing. And all we're doing in this one is exposing that in the self-service UI with a set of UI and APIs. And then now for the console access. So for the console access, these guys can be running without a network or on an isolated network. And we support any member things, including not having an OS. We need a new version of the RDP client that supports this standard. So this is a standard so that third parties can go and create their own solution. So even though Microsoft is shipping them within remote desktop and Windows Server, somebody else can use that same standard to build their own client if they want to. And as you saw, it's exposed in the Windows Azure pack. And you need this R2 versions of System Center and Windows Server because we made innovations in all the areas to get that to work. Okay, so now let's talk about a little bit about how that works. Okay, so the red side on the left is client side, and then the green side is provider side. So what happens is that the browser, when I click that button, created a request to the portal, which is running on the back end, right? And that asks, it says System Center 2012 R2. So it asks System Center to verify the user has access to that VM, then generates a token that will be used by the browser. So it goes back, issues that, the browser downloads that to your client, and then uses the RDP updated client to go back and talk to the remote desktop gateway. And then that thing lets you into the particular host. We have to establish trust as well using a PKI, right? Public-private keys, where the private key is generated by the System Center, and we put the public keys down on the host and the gateway. And those allow and trust that SPF will, or the System Center will generate those tokens, and that's how they validate them. Those tokens have a timer on them, so it's a configurable setting. So in a public environment, make them those pretty short, a couple minutes maybe. But it's configurable. So like in a demo environment, I might have it up to 5 minutes or something. Okay, so that's, and the details are here. I think we added some information in the notes as well, so that when you download the slides later, you'll get a lot more details about that. Okay, with that, I'll turn it back over to Eric, and I'll come back later to do admin stuff.
Thanks, Mark. I always love it when we do the demo and people ask questions about Windows Azure proper, because I feel like we definitely nailed consistency when we get confused about whether we're seeing Azure or the Windows Azure pack running at a service provider or on-premise. One thing to note about that is when we demo it, we show it so that it really looks like Azure. We color it the same. We logo it similarly. But it is configurable. So if you want to run a portal, if you're going to run this portal, but you want to brand it like your service provider or brand it like your corporate identity, there are some options for you to make it look how you want it to look. I mean, there's some constraints on that as well, but you don't have to just stand it up looking like your Azure and having people confused. There are some options to tweak it so you get a little differentiation. So we're gonna deep dive into how we built the gallery specifically and what the pieces are there and somewhat how you would then go build your own gallery items, because it's really an open, we hope to foster an open ecosystem around this so that it becomes it's easy to share these with colleagues or innovate to differentiate yourself in the market. And here's just a few definitions on this. Top line is sort of conceptual. You know, we talk about the gallery. We may reference a gallery item. And then we talk about the virtual machine role itself. Typically, when we say virtual machine role, we're talking about the deployed instance. And the gallery items and the gallery is talking about that catalog of templates. So we try to use that language that way. It gets a little confusing because technically a virtual machine role you can use to describe those gallery items as well. But we try and stick with that lingo throughout. And then underlying every gallery item There are a number of artifacts, and they exist for a reason. There are separate artifacts for a reason. And the three main artifacts you're going to interact with are there's a view definition, and that helps the portal generate the user interface that you saw. So pages 2 and 3 of that user interface, the virtual machine container settings, the application settings, those pages are completely generated on the fly. So it depends on what options you want to restrict and which options you want to give to your end user, how you want to configure the container. And that's the view def. The view def is all about the container. The container is the res def. And the resource lingo here is intentional. So we're implementing the virtual machine role resource. In the greater picture, there'll be a website resource. There'll be a worker role resource. There'll be a web role resource. So this resource terminology is part of the sort of cloud service terminology that you hear the Windows Azure team talk about. And every resource will have this resdef file. And so there'll be resdef files for all kinds of resources, and they're generic in name but specific in content. And the resource definition will refer to the applications you want to install in it. And every application, we'll go through this, is somewhat self-contained. So eventually, you can pick 2 or 3 of these apps and put them on one machine, even though the application authors may not know how you're going to use it. In this release, we're restricting for every resource definition, you can refer to, at most, one resource extension. So it's one-to-one in this release. Eventually, it'll be more than one in there, and then that's just the resource definition author needs to ensure that it's all going to work on one machine, but the model supports that. And I'll just leave these here for your reference. We're going to go into detail in all of them. This is another picture of kind of how it all fits together. Primarily that container definition, you can see it referencing the application that's in the extension. The UI wizard primarily exists so the user interface can generate, as Mark showed you, that configuration, the user entered values. And then that's all submitted to Virtual Machine Manager so we can stand up. There is a cloud service. So much like, I don't know if you saw Mark Rusinovich's talk, much like today's IaaS in Azure has a hidden cloud service, in this release of the Windows Azure Pack, we have a cloud service and we're also hiding it. Right? But it's there because we do want to align eventually with all that cloud service knowledge of how you assemble these together. So there's a hidden cloud service. In that cloud service, there's a virtual machine role container. And in the virtual machine role container, there's one or more VMs. And then there's that resource configuration, and I'm going to go into detail. We haven't talked a lot about that. Just another view. This gives you a feeling for what are the settings that are in each file, just conceptually. I'm going to go into detail of these, but just, you know, quickly. We use the application extension to configure both the OS and the virtual machine container. The reason we configure the operating system in the application section is because applications have dependencies on roles and features. So even if the only thing you want to do is enable a Windows role and configure it, you need a resource extension. But typically, you're enabling that so you can put a website on it or put a database in it or whatever you're doing. So it seems a little unnatural sometimes, but it's basically inside the VM versus the shape of the VM. That's how you should think of the application side versus the virtual machine container. The OS image requirements and the networking, and it is parameterized. I'm going to show you how that works. Then the next one over, the resource definition, that's the size of the VM. It is the artifact that refers to a virtual hard disk. So there's a bit of this requirements of the OS in the application, but the container defines what OS image to use. And I'm going to go through in detail how we do that link up, because there's some things you need to do in VMM to make that work. And then the resource definition refers to the resource extension and supplies 100% of the resource extension's parameters. In addition, the resource definition has its own parameters. They don't need to be the same as the resource extension's parameters. So you can include a resource extension and hard code his values and not ask your user about them. Or you can include an application and say, oh, he needed a port value. I guess I'll ask my user. So it's completely flexible. The view def only helps the user fill out the resource definition parameters. So if you're passing through a resource extension parameter, you sort of redefine it and pass it through. So there's a level of indirection there that's intentional that gives more flexibility to the resource definition author of how they want to configure all the apps they're building inside. And the view def does grouping, ordering, validation, localization. It's really about presentation layer. In fact, as we've been playing around with demos, there's a lot of times where we just go tweak the view def, tweak the view def, tweak the view def. It's really great that when we do that, we're never afraid we're going to break a deployment because the deployment artifacts we haven't touched. So it's turned out to be really flexible for us in terms of as we're building the product and getting it out there. So I think you'll find the same for yourselves. And then there's this deployment configuration. And that's really, the user gave a bunch of answers. We have an artifact for that because we version it. We version it so that if the user makes a change, we can do lifecycle management. So every one of these artifacts has a version, and we sort of keep those in sync as you go. And I'll go through that in detail. So let's take a look at the application extension, the resext. I've sort of highlighted in bold on the left side and the corresponding blue in this document. So the first thing you'll probably notice is it's JSON. It's not XML. Right? This was intentional. We made this decision in conjunction with the Azure team so that it was a really REST-friendly, web-friendly, portal-friendly format. So that's sometimes that surprises people, but this is the format we're going with. And you'll see at the top of all these files, there's some unique identifier. For the resource extension, it goes by name, publisher, and version. So here it's IaaS Demo 2. The publisher is Microsoft. And it's versioned as 1.0.0.0. So that identifies this resource extension artifact. It's parameterized, as I said. You'll see the parameterization syntax there around IaaS port. And you'll notice lower down in the blue, there's a blue command line highlighted where it says square bracket param dot IaaS port. And that is right over here. This is how you use the parameter. This is how you define the parameter. So throughout the document, that's how that looks on all the artifacts. You see, we're going to enable Windows Server roles and features. And you do it, you just list the role. Always, we're just enabling them. So you just give us a list of roles and features you want enabled. We'll take care of it. Command line, we actually have first better support here for command line-based installation than we had in VMM in the past. So if you change the arguments to your command line, we treat it as a servicing operation, and we'll recall your script on the endpoint. We never did that in the past. So there's really powerful support for command line scripting so that if you want to integrate Puppet or Chef or PowerShell DSC, so I did a demo in the PowerShell DSC session where we hooked this up and to configure our VM, we just used PowerShell desired state. So whatever you're using to configure VMs should fit nicely with this model in terms of running your scripts. We also have first-class support for doing SQL specialization, for loading SQL applications that are packaged in the SQL DAC format, for using web deploy for IaaS app. So if you're using those common packaging formats, we have first-class sections, which I'm not showing here, that make it really easy. And this is, as Mark said, something you need to import into VMM before you can use it. So it's pre-imported and cached in VMM, and that's because we need all the application payload in VMM so that creating the VM is faster. You can't upload your big app payload when you want to do a deployment. People want deployment to be fast. Okay, so how does the virtual machine definition make use of that? So first, still common identifier, name, publisher, version. Helps to uniquely identify this. You see, this artifact has parameters as well. Here we've parameterized the size of the VM. That's where Mark showed you the drop-down list of extra small through extra large. And here we've chosen to ask the user for IaaS port, which happened to also be a resource extension parameter. So you'll notice we define our own parameter, and down here where we reference the resource extension, we have to provide all of its parameters. And here we're binding our IaaS port parameter to the underlying resource extension's IaaS port parameter. They're sort of unfortunately named the same here, but they're different parameters. I could have just as easily said 80. I'm not asking. When we deploy websites, they always go to port 80, right? So here I could make a flexible decision in the app, but hard code it when we choose to deploy it in this setup. So there's flexibility there. And then you'll notice here that it's just more use of the parameter here around VM size. Okay, so let's talk about the view def, because this is very interesting of how are you going to ask the user in a consistent and friendly way what to do. So there's a bit of the constructs we have in here are around grouping and ordering. So you group using this section and category construct. So there's two levels of grouping. What you saw in the demo was a page about the virtual machine and a page about the application. The way we achieve that is we have two sections, the virtual machine section and the app section, which we'd recommend you follow that pattern. It seems to make sense to people. You ask all the virtual machine questions on the virtual machine page, and you ask all the app questions on the app page. And the ordering within within those pages, which are the sections, you can do categories. And that's so you can group some of the parameters together and give a little label to the subgrouping on the page. And then within the groups, you can order, and the ordering is all just the order in this document. So you don't have to put indexes or anything. Just put them in the order you want. That's the order that will be on the page. So that's how sections and categories and ordering work. You'll notice labels and descriptions throughout here. So there's things like title is this double curly bracket syntax, right? And certainly if you aren't familiar with JSON, you'll come to love and hate the quotes and curly brackets and everything that you see here, part of the price of admission. The double quotes, and I'll just sort of jump to the bottom of my slide here, the double curly bracket notation is how we handle localization in this file. So those double curly brackets tell the portal, take the inner curly bracket string and look it up in a resource file that's specific to the language that the browser submitted when it asked for the page. So these pages can all be fully localized into whatever languages you choose. And the portal will look up the strings according to this notation. And that just is, you give a resource file per language in a directory per language. There's also a notion in here of default language. So if the browser submits some language and you don't have that resource, then we just use the default instead. So, and you can tweak that too. So you can decide, I want my default in French, and I'll support other languages, right, whatever makes sense for you. The types of parameters that we support, here's a listing. So pretty common types, Boolean number string, secure string, credential. Those are all pretty primitive. And then there's some special ones, like computer name pattern. So that's what you saw was some string, pound, pound, pound. We auto-generate then the computer names based on your pattern that you submit. And we have special validation rules for those strings. You also see something like VM size. So how does that work? So as Mark said, in Virtual Machine Manager, we've added a new VM size profile object. There's extra small through extra large, and you can update what you want the cores and memory to be for those settings. And when the portal sees that you're declaring a parameter of VM size, it queries the back end for all the available sizes and then shows that drop-down list what they mean. So it's a sort of dynamic special handshake with the back end around VM size. And that is customizable for your implementation. And then there is the OS image, the OS virtual hard disk. I have a whole slide on this, but you'll notice that here we're saying that I need OS virtual hard disks that are tagged as Windows Server 2012 and tagged with Data Center. So this is just a pretty flexible hash tagging scheme, and we'll come out with guidance around what we think common tagging should be. So you're able to ask again the service provider, give me the list of VHDs that are tagged like this, and that'll produce a list of VHDs that should work for this app. And that gives some flexibility as well. So there's a lot of apps that'll work on Windows Server 2012 or Windows Server 2012 R2. So do you need two templates for that? You don't. You can just say, you know, Windows Server 2012 or higher, or figure out, you know, and again, we'll come out with some guidance around what we think tagging should be to allow some flexibility. But then this gives the user really great flexibility. They come through, they get a list of images that'll work, and they get to choose which one they want. Different SKUs, different, which might be different prices. So again, there's a lot of flexibility around mapping to the OS VHD. In the past, we've always hard-coded. You get this VHD with this template, and that was kind of really restrictive. This is a much better loose coupling. And then you'll notice there's also parameter validation here at the bottom. Might be a little hard to see, where you get to define min range, max range for some of these number values, things like that. So it's pretty flexible how you want to control. And you saw that as well, where Mark was constrained at 5 VMs for scale-out, right? That's not a platform constraint. Just a policy that was put on that gallery item. There might be another one you let scale out even higher. All right, there might be another one where you let the user choose their max scale. Then they're constrained within that bound. So there's a lot of flexibility here for that. Lots of JSON. Then lastly is that, what's the resource configuration, right? So it's generated by the portal. You saw in the previous slide we wanted to know about VM size and IaaS port. So the resource configuration says, oh, IaaS port is 80, role size small. And then there's like computer name pattern and network name. What are you choosing? If you choose null, then we get the default value, those types of things. So this is pretty flexible here. It is versioned so that we know if you want to change to port 8080, then resubmit the resource configuration, and we will service all the VMs to apply that change, to rerun the deployment against those VMs, you know, as it makes sense. We don't store it as a file. The others are all file artifacts that are stored somewhere. This is just stored in the Virtual Machine Manager database as a versioned entity and given back to the portal when it wants to show the config page. It's not persisted as a file. Okay, so again, a little bit about the OS image handling, because it's a little tricky. I've talked about this a few times, and we typically talked about it sort of from the bottoms up, and it occurred to me as we were putting this deck together, we might want to flip it a little bit. So this is a way of talking about it that really you want to parameterize this setting, right? You don't want to bind to a specific VHD. It's interesting that in the model, you can't actually bind to a specific VHD anyway. So the preferred method is to use tagging. The viewdef will have a filtered list of tags. Each resource extension has a list of its requirements. And these are decoupled today. So the viewdef doesn't get the resource extension and look at its list. The viewdef is separate. Primarily, that's somewhat due to time constraints. It's also because eventually you have more than one resource extension, so the viewdef is a union of those tags. You might also choose in your environment to add tags to the viewdef to provide further restrictions, even though the application doesn't dictate that. So you can further restrict if you want to, for some reason, for your gallery item, for a specific plan, you want people using the data center SKU, or you want to only using 2012 R2, the underlying artifact may not require that same restriction. So you can be more restrictive. This gives you flexibility. We'll provide guidance. Typical guidance today is we want to have a bunch of more simplistic tags that you can AND together instead of having a big Windows Server 2012 data center with .NET, one tag like that. It restricts your flexibility if you overload the tags. You can, and we may do that in some circumstances, but we're hoping to get a bunch of more primitive tags that allow better mix and matching, like you see here. And we do enforce the tagging. So if you try to pick if you don't restrict it in the viewdef, and someone picks the Ubuntu image to build out an IIS server, we will say, okay, that didn't have the Windows Server tag, so this deployment is blocked at the VMM level. So there is an enforcement, only that the minimum set of tags are met, not that every tag, you know, we don't know what the viewdef tags are anyway, so all we can do in our layer is say, the VHD you referenced seems like it's going to work for this resource extension, for this app. So we do enforce those on deployment. And then, really, the way this works is the tags bring back the VHD, and the VHD has a property of family name and release in Virtual Machine Manager, and the model has the referencing language in the model is name colon version. So even when you bring back the VHD and you reference it, you're not directly mapping some storage path that specifically points to one VHD. You're just referencing a family name and release. The power in Virtual Machine Manager for that is we have this notion of equivalency, where when you say I want a VHD of a certain family and release, depending on where you're deploying, we can pick the closest VHD. So even if you hard code it, there's an ability at the service provider to say, oh, okay, you hard coded it, but I'll just go ahead and name, I'll tag one of my VHDs with the family and release. So I still get a little flexibility. I don't need you to give me the VHD, even if you specifically, if you don't parameterize this setting. And that's how we do the mapping in the instance, in that when we're doing a deployment, we look for the closest VHD with the right family and release, and we pull it forward. One thing to note here is in VMM, the release is just a string. But in the model for these new artifacts, the version must be 1.n.n.n.n.n. So the model is more restrictive than VMM, so you have to be careful when you set it that you don't have a trailing, you know, goo and you don't have extra stuff in there. You didn't put a V in it or whatever, those kind of things. It has to be an exact match, but it's not restricted right now in the VMM platform, but it is restricted in the model. So that's how that works. The way we deliver gallery items, and we are going to be having some available as samples, like I said, and there's lots of interest amongst product teams in Microsoft to provide these. So it's been very well received within Microsoft so far. So we'll be cranking these out as much as we can. You'll get one package that'll have two packages in it. And they're the .resdef package and the .resext package, right? And they pretty much, the resource definition package, as Mark said, gets loaded into SPF for the portal to handle, and the application package gets preloaded into Virtual Machine Manager. And these are just the contents of the package. So we talked about the resdef and the viewdef file, the icon you saw, all the language files, everything. That's all in that resdef package. And the resx package really is our artifact in JSON, the resx file, and all of your payload for your app, your scripts, your app payload, your ISOs, whatever it is you need, goes in that package. This is just another flow that we put in here for how you do it. Mark talked through some of this on his other slide as well. So, you know, you download the packages, put one in VMM. Then there's that third slide about verification is something you need to do. So we don't, when you import, we don't block you if you don't have a VHD with the right tagging. We didn't want to put that amount of constraints on just getting these things into the system. So there is some homework once you've imported to make sure it's going to work. You can test these things in VMM using PowerShell. So you can sort of make sure VMM is going to work and then pop up a level. There's other things you need to do in Virtual Machine Manager to get these to work. You have to have a cloud. You have to have self-service user roles. Right, you have to set those up right, and we'll have better guidance here, but effectively, you know, the VHDs need to be accessible to the cloud users and all that kind of stuff. So this is all standard 2012 SP1 stuff in Virtual Machine Manager that we're leveraging in this new virtual machine role. And you can verify these at the different layers in the stack so that you're not just always starting at the top, and if something goes wrong, you can't tell what's happening. And this is just what's going to happen, and I think this should probably make sense, but I'm just going to talk through it because it's the mechanics. So what happens when someone opens that wizard, right? First, they're given the list of gallery items. They pick one. They go through the wizard and provide their values. And then the wizard generates that resconfig artifact. So the portal never reads the resource definition. It only reads the view definition. And it reads that so it can generate the resource config. Then it gives the resource config to the API layer. Underlying that, SPF will read the resource definition and pass the config and the definition into VMM and say, hey, create this VM role. Then VMM will look at the resource definition and figure out what app it's referencing, pull that out, apply the config, and then deploy all the VM role and virtual machines. So sort of at every layer, we pull another artifact out and pass it down. And put it all together. All right. You going to do this demo, Mark?
All right, so Eric talked about the admin side, so I'll just show what you have to do there. This one. All right, so the first thing you want to do is import stuff into VMM. Okay, so I have here stocktrader-sql-res-xpkg. Okay, and that guy needs to go into VMM. So first thing I need to do is tag the VHD. So I can do virtual. So I'm going to, okay, so you can see what's already there. First I can go. Start copy and paste it pretty soon. Family name. So the name is the name of the VHD. Family name is the OS name, I think, and then release is the version, and then the tag is the tags. So you can see here I have some VHDs here that have already family name, release, and tag set because I was, you know, doing a bunch of gallery items. So what I want to do now is add the tags for, I'll just show it here. So I'm just going to get the VHD with this name, and then I'm going to set release and family name to be those things right there. Okay? I'm just going to paste those in since I'm tired of typing. Hit return, right? There we go. Sorry about that. Okay. And then I can just do requery, do it there. And now you see that the family name and release are set for this particular gallery item. Okay. The next thing I need to do is import the resource extension. So this one, I just define where the library share is and what the name of it is. I set the path on disk on my client where that file is. So this guy right here, this stock trader. So what I do is I go copy as path, and then I paste the thing in there. And then I run the actual commandlet to import the cloud resource extension. And I just give it a path, which is set up here, and a description, and then the library share. So I'm going to paste that guy in all at one shot. And hit return. And you know you're doing it right because that thing pops up. And it actually takes a minute or two to import that because it has a lot of stuff in it, a bunch of MSIs and stuff. So I'm just going to, I guess we can wait for that to get done. You have a question? Yeah, the question is, where do you put the tags versus the family name? Yeah, and so we're going to come up with an authoring guide. I think we need to, build more gallery items before telling anybody else what, you know. So we've only done a few so far, and I have multiple teams trying it as well. So it's bad for us to do it because we already know all the details and stuff. So. All right, so relatively soon this will be done importing. I think I'm going to flip over to the portal and then come back to this because I want to wait. So over here on the, where do you put that? Right here? Okay, so now I have the admin portal over here. So now I'm in the service admin portal of the Windows Azure pack. Okay, I'm over here in the virtual machine clouds, and over here there's something called gallery. So I can click on this import button, And unlike VMM, where I have to type a bunch of PowerShell, but you know, people that use VMM, they love PowerShell. And the people that you know use the Azure UI, you just like to click a button. So I just pick the stock trader SQL V1 res dev PKG, hit open, go, and that, oh, fails. Oh, no. It's already there. I don't know why it failed. Oh, you know what? Let me do one more thing. F5. Refresh. Sometimes it doesn't like when it. It's in a funny state if it just sits there for a while. That. Gallery. Try one more time. Open. Go. Yeah, that's better. Okay. Just had it hit F5 when in doubt. Okay, so that's in. So you see here, now I have a gallery item. If I can click into there, you can see it has some information about that. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to make it available to tenants by saying make public. And go. Okay, now that's what it does to make it available. But now I still have to add it to a plan. The plan won't let me add it to it until the resource extension is in VMM. So we actually do checks if the gallery item has a dependency on VMM before we ACL it, because we set ACLs both in the tenant layer in SPF as well as the back-end VMM user role. So I have to wait for that thing to get done importing before I move on. Where is it? Oh, it's way over there. There. Okay, so now it's done importing. Okay. And what I can do is I can go something like get dash, right? And then I can just type in, and now you can see that the stock trader dash SQL app has, resource extension has been loaded into VMM. So now the UI will let me add it to a plan for a tenant. So I'll go down here to plans. I'll pick, I don't know, the I don't know, the platinum plan, I might already have it though. So I go down here, I go down to virtual machine clouds. I think I got rid of it. Down here, there's gallery items that'll be loaded. And yes, hit add gallery item. This is the one that I just imported, right? And I can hit that. Okay, so now it's imported. And now if I go over and it'll take, so what'll happen then is that you'll see that, I'm going to hit save first. You save the plan. So what's happening now is that I saved in the plan. Now the service management API is now ongoing and updating all the subscriptions that are associated with that plan to give them ACLs to be able to get in and see that gallery item. So if you see over here, this probably says quota update in progress like that. And then what that's really doing is that it's updating that user role in VMM, and that's all it's doing. Okay, so now it's already said plan is public, which means now the end user should be able to see it. So if I go over here, hit F5 again, I should be able to see it down in here. So if I go new, I'll have to wait for the extension to load. Okay, new, virtual machine role from gallery. Yeah, and this is the guy that we just added, Publisher Contoso. So there you go. So it's not that bad to end-to-end, to import into VMM, to add it to SPF, to the service admin portal in SPF, and then to publish it out to users, publish it to plans, and it pretty quickly gets out to the users. And I could revoke it the same way as if I wanted to as well, by unpublishing it or by removing it from plans.
to do this yourselves. There's a couple resources we will be providing, you know, shortly after this preview release gets made public. We are going to provide a sample list of gallery items. There's a couple places we're looking at that right now. There's a TechNet gallery. You may see some things show up there. We're considering experimenting with a WebPI feed. If folks use WebPI, we may publish these on a WebPI feed. We're going to start simple, and then we'll increase this list over time. Once the preview is out, we'll be releasing these periodically throughout the summer, you know, as we head towards the second half of the year and the final release. So you'll see a cadence on these, but we'll initially give you at least a Windows Server basic one. We'll give you the IaaS one you saw today. We'll probably release the stock trader one. We'll release a bunch of these so you guys can pull them down as samples and take a look and use them and tweak them yourselves. Along with that, we'll have an authoring and best practice guide. And that'll cover stuff like tagging and common tags and that kind of stuff so that it helps you put these together and follow some common principles. We don't right now have any plans for any kind of authoring tool set for this. You know, we're looking at our options there and trying to figure out what we can do that's highest value, least cost at this point. So feedback so far has been, once you get the hang of it, it's not that bad, but it's a lot of text editing in JSON. So we are going to try and do something, whether we just do something on the open source side or something like that, just to get something out that folks can use, because it's a little tedious. Okay, and these are a bunch of related sessions, half of which might be over, right? There's a lot of System Center and Windows Azure Pack sessions in this list. So if you have more interest in some of the details specifically around, you know, networking, storage, those kind of things for the fabric management, there's a lot of sessions on that. So go ahead and check these out if you want to learn more about the stuff in general. Okay, and with that, I think we're done with questions. And all right, thank you.